start with why I'm here and why we should all learn about computational thinking. I'm here because I feel it's my responsibility as a student of computer science to talk about the fact that computer science is a field that is just as wonderful and just as accessible as any other. I'd also like to clarify that computational thinking is not coding itself. Computational thinking is the mindset in which we computer scientists are in when they're coding. Today I'll be showing you a few examples of where you already use computational thinking in your daily lives, and I'll be contrasting them with examples of where I would use computational thinking when coding. Computational thinking is a mindset. It's universally applicable, and it's useful for anyone. This is an infographic of all of the different concepts and approaches used in computational thinking. But today I'll be going over the concepts. I'll be going into detail over each one of them and showing you two different examples, one from possibly your lives and one from a computer scientist's life. Logic. We use logic in everyday life to make decisions. In Ultimate Frisbee, we use logic when we're setting a force. I'll take this with me. So when I'm on defense and I'm marking a player who has a better forehand throw than a backhand throw, I would automatically assume that it's smarter to block their forehand throw. So I would stand in the way of the throw so that then they can't make the pass to whoever they're trying to pass to, and it makes their job a lot harder. In computer science, I would use logic to create a program to do something for me and make my life a lot easier. For example, if I was trying to convert number grids to letter grids, then I would create a series of statements that would sound something like this. If number grade is equal to 93 or above, then letter grade should equal A. Else if number grade is greater than 90, the letter grade should be A minus, and so on. Algorithms are a series of steps used to reach a certain goal. They're really like recipes, and my best example would be making pancakes. It's a series of steps which you use to get a stack of pancakes. And the thing about algorithms which is special is that sometimes you can use a series of steps in a loop to create a much shorter procedure for yourself. In computer science, I'd use algorithms for things like getting information to a user much faster. Google uses something called prefetching, which is the act of bringing data closer to a user by predicting what they're going to search. How it works is when you type in a couple of letters into the search bar, it figures out all the possible things you could be searching and pulls all that information closer to you so that when you press the enter button, it knows exactly what to pull from that cache of data. Decomposition. Decomposition is the act of breaking down problems into smaller, more manageable ones, and they often are independently solvable. Let's take the play, for example. The play is made up of several different components, which all work separately until the end. Stagecraft works on the set and the props, and they don't need the light and the sound to be working perfectly in order to do their job. The lights and the sound can be worked perfectly fine if they were given a couple of tries to fix the timing and the placement of actors on stage, and they're pretty much done after that. And choreography can be done separately. It does not need to be done with sets or the lighting on stage every single time. It just needs to be done once. Of course, it's important for all of it to come together into one piece in the end. Decomposition used in computer science can be used for things like website development. In the Facebook website, there is a chat bar on the right-hand side which will show you all of your contacts and show you whether or not they are available to chat at the moment. The code that goes into creating that bar and shows you all of your contacts, that code is created by one person. the code that goes into making a separate chat box for one contact which you would have selected, that code is most likely created by someone else. And the important thing to note is that these two people, they don't need to look at each other's code in order for their own to work. Pattern recognition. We use pattern recognition in our daily lives all the time. We use it in math extensively, and we also use it in chemistry when figuring out what a chemical compound would be based on certain patterns you would see inside of their formulas. So this is a really cool example of where we use pattern recognition in computer science. In computer science, we use pattern recognition for face ID. Face ID basically is this function where the first time when you set up Face ID, it projects a series of light dots onto your face and creates a map on your face. And there's a separate camera in your phone which takes snapshots of only those dots on your face. And every time you open up your phone to unlock it, it will just take a new snapshot of your face with the dots on it and compare it to the previously taken ones. If it's a match, you can get into the phone. If it's not, then you can't. It's pretty simple. Abstraction. Abstraction is the act of ignoring unnecessary details. Take a look at this image. What do you see? Yeah, it's a guitar. And you knew that because you ignored all of the unnecessary details in the picture. Now, there are several layers of abstraction, and I can tell you about those through a car, actually. A driver only needs to know the highest level of abstraction. They only need to know where the wheel is, where the accelerator is, where the brakes are, and where the stick shift is. And they need to know what each one does. They don't need to know how to change the engine oil, and they don't need to know how to change the transmission fluid. That's the job of the mechanic. The mechanic's job is to know the next layer of abstraction down. They need to know what's inside the car. There's an engine in the car, there's a transmission in the car, there's a radiator, and there's exhaust. They don't need to know the physics that goes into making the engine. That's the mechanical engineer's job. He's the next level down, or he or she, for that fact. And they are responsible for the physics behind the engine. What I'm trying to get at is that each person has their own level of abstraction which they have to pay attention to. And if they were to pay attention to multiple, things would get pretty strange. For example, if I was driving on the road and I was thinking about physics in terms of the engine in my car, I'd most likely get into a crash. Abstraction used in computer science is best exemplified by a phone. When you open up your phone, the first thing you see is a bunch of colorful app icons. The person behind those app icons is an icon designer. They only need to know the purpose of the app that they are designing an icon for. They don't need to know the code that goes into it. They don't need to know the logic that goes into it. All they need to know is the purpose. The next layer down would be the UI developer, or the user interface developer. They're responsible for connecting the app to touching the app icon to opening up the app. They still don't know the logic that goes into the code for the app, and they still don't know what the app actually looks like on the inside. Now, the next level down would be the app developer. They're responsible for all of the logic that goes into making this app. But they don't know how the hardware in the phone works to store all the information about the app. Now that you know the five pillars of computational thinking, I hope you can see that you already have the tools to become a computational thinker. And with a little bit of formal training, we all can make a lot of progress in our respective fields. Thank you.